The verses of the Quran that I recited before you, the first one was from Surah Ar-Rum. And in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. And from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He created from you, for you, your spouses. And one of the reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted you a spouse was so that you may seek tranquility and peace and joy within one another. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And He placed between the two of you mawadda and rahma. Mawadda, according to Mujahid, who was a famous commentator of the Quran, is your passionate love for you to be attracted to one another. And the second, rahma, is your compassionate love, that you should have mercy upon one another. Unfortunately, we live in a time where people are losing the ability to love their own spouse. We are so kind and nice to everyone we see on the streets. You know, a person that we meet at work, we're so kind when we open the door for them and we smile at them. And we offer someone coffee at work, we smile and give it to them. And anyone that shows a kind gesture to us, we're always saying thank you and you're welcome to them. We're so kind to the whole world. But the one place where our kindness never sees is the house and the home. Our spouses don't see our kindness. And the reality is that we live in a time that in the United States of America, every minute there are 20 people who are physically abused by someone who they consider to be an intimate partner. In the United States of America, when it comes to domestic violence, 85% of our domestic violence, the victims of it are the women in our community. And 15%, the victims of it are the men in our community. In the United States of America, every single year, there are 4,774,000 women who are abused by someone who they consider to be a beloved one. Domestic violence is a reality. We need to stop ignoring it. And the minbar needs to be the place where this is addressed from. In our own community in Dallas, this week we had an epic episode of domestic violence where a husband took a gun and put it against his wife. And this is a Muslim man and a Muslim lady. And he put a gun against her head and he killed her right there. And all of the people in the media are sharing this report. And this, I read this in more than one media outlet. I was at the gym the other day and one guy came and sat next to me. And he said to me, I wasn't wearing my thobe, I was wearing my gym clothes. And he said to me that I don't like Muslims. This, he said it very openly to me. And when he said this to me, I asked him, do you have any Muslim friends? He said, no. So I said, why do you not like Muslims? So he said, every time I read a report or I hear in the news that a lady was killed in a family or someone was abused, I don't have to even read the finishing part of that report to know that the perp behind this act was a Muslim. Now obviously his statement is overstretched and he's sharing his biased view, which I dealt with while I was speaking with him. But for us, the Muslim community, this is something for us to reflect over. We were the people who were supposed to stand for justice. Our religion was the fix. It was a solution to domestic violence and abuse. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw domestic abuse in his community and he prohibited them from doing that. Allah azza wa jalla says in the Quran in Surah An-Nisa, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la yahillu lakum an tarithu an-nisaa karha. That the Arabs had this practice that when someone would die, his relatives would come, and just as they would inherit the wealth, someone would come and claim his wife and say, I'm inheriting this person's wife. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran very clearly, this sort of act is from ignorance. It has no place in Islam. This is clear and absolute abuse. If the lady wishes to move into that person's marriage, that's another thing. But to come and claim her like she's some sort of a car, that this is my car now, that's not what Islam advocates. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, right? وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. In that same ayah, Allah continues on to say, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. And live your lives with your spouses and with the women in a suitable and appropriate manner. Respect them. Just as you would want to be respected, learn to respect your spouse too. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us, فَإِنْ كَرِهْتُمُوهُنَّ. And if there is something about your spouse that bothers you, because that's a reality, no one's going to be perfect. Just as there are certain things that bother you about your spouse, know that there are things that bother your spouse about you. But they haven't lifted their hand against you yet. فَإِنْ كَرِهْتُمُهُنَّ. And if there is something that bothers you about your spouse, فَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا. Then it may be possible that you dislike one thing. وَيَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed so much good inside it on the other hand. There might be one thing that bothers you. But look at all the other good that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you with. Our marriages are supposed to be a place of peace and tranquility. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. We're supposed to be able to come home and smile and be happy and be energetic and feel proud to be in the company of our spouse. We're supposed to be happy, and our hearts are supposed to be lifted when we look at our spouse and when we're in their company, not want to run away from them. And when your house loses peace, when there's constant bickering, fighting, argumentation that happens within the four walls of the house, then you must know that that house now is no longer has the barakah of marriage in it. The legality of marriage may be sound, but the barakah that's supposed to come with marriage, the love that's supposed to come with marriage, that won't be there anymore. And then when that's not there, then you're going to find frustration in the household. And when people get frustrated regularly, and when people get frustrated and they can't control it anymore, then foolish and weak people will result to, they will then turn towards domestic violence and abuse. And that's where our community is today. We the Muslims were the ones who had the solution to this. We had the fix for this. You know, in Nigeria, there was a case in which during the British rule, there was a case where a husband killed his wife. The Muslim judge gave the ruling that the husband will be killed in return because he killed an innocent wife. It was a British judge who was present there who overturned that ruling. And the Muslim judge said to him that Islam is the solution to domestic violence. When someone is an aggressor, we have a solution of how to deal with that aggression. And the Quran teaches us to stay away from that aggression. We find in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he teaches us again and again to be patient and calm, to be patient and calm. We hear about these lectures. We hear about these important characteristics of being patient and having forbearance and lowering our gaze when we're angry and controlling our thoughts and our heart when we're angry. But we don't translate what we learn in the masjid into reality. It just becomes a theory. It's an idea that we have in our mind. And when we walk out of the doors of the masjid, that idea is gone. And we turn back to ourselves, or we then begin to gloat and boast over, yes, I was at Jum'ah Salah, and I never miss a Jum'ah Salah, and I'm always there first in the saf for the Jum'ah Salah. But the question to you is, in all the years of you sitting first in the masjid for Jum'ah Salah, has that made you a better person? Why can't we, the society, see you being a better person? Why isn't your family seeing those khutbahs that you heard translate into something practical within the four walls of the household? You know, we have to stop viewing the Muslim community. We need to stop viewing ourselves immune to the ills of society. If this is a problem in America, we are a part of the fabric of America, and the problem is a part of our problem too. Many of us, we come from cultures where domestic abuse and abuse to your spouse or to your children or to your beloved ones is something that is tolerated. As long as you're a man, go ahead and do whatever you want to. Maybe that's a part of our culture. I'm not accusing all cultures, but maybe a culture or subculture may be more tolerant to this. Or it's possible that some people sitting here may think that, you know what, by me lifting my hand a little, it shows how big of a macho man I am and how I have control of the household. And then there are those of us who are foolish enough to start quoting the Quran to justify our anger issues. And we say in the Quran how the Quran says, وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ. And this now gives me the license to pick up my axe and chop off anything I want to, and take out my lash and beat anyone up I want to, because the Quran gives me permission to do so. First and foremost, unless you are a mufassir of the Quran who understands every element of the Quran, be aware and be careful of going to the Quran and interpreting its legal affairs before turning to the scholars and seeing what they have to say about these verses and reading the context of these verses. Secondly, if you do want to read the Quran and you want to go to those verses and you want to pull them out and quote them out of context, how about we look at those verses in the context of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where Aisha radiallahu anha herself says, when she was asked, someone asked her, describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to us, and she says, "Kana khuluquhu al-Quran." His characteristics were a manifestation of the Quran. He lived the Quran. Every act of his, every statement of his, was supported by the Quran directly. And if you accept the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, and if you accept hadith as a form of legislation and a point of reference for us Muslims and a sunnah that we should all look up to bring into our lives, if you accept that, then I challenge you to bring one hadith that shows us that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ever laid his blessed hand on one of his family members. Bam! There's no answer to that. Because we all know for a fact that that's not possible. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would never do such a thing. But some people say, oh, my spouse, they frustrate me. Sometimes my wife makes me very angry, or my children make me very angry, or my sibling makes me very angry. That's why I resort to this. One husband and a wife came to my office, and the wife's telling me that my husband physically abuses me. And I asked him, I said to him, why do you do that? And he said to me that she makes me angry. And I said to him, I dare you, the next time the cop pulls you over and gives you a ticket, why don't you go and hit him? And don't tell me he doesn't make you angry. Everyone gets frustrated when a cop pulls you over. Your heart starts reeking with anger and you want to do something, but you know the guy in front of you is a place of authority and your anger is not going to do much. So stop flexing muscle on someone who may not be able to defend themselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may have given you physical strength, but any person who is given something by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is accountable by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what you're given.